Jefferson's first administration was absolutely a success. He purchased Louisiana and the Louisiana Territory for very little cost to the U.S. Treasury. This doubled the size of the United States. If you have that on your resume for president, that is going to be pretty impressive. So Jefferson, he actually has one of the most successful first terms that any president in U.S. history will ever have. Unfortunately for Jefferson, he's going to enter his second term dealing with a lot of foreign problems, and these foreign problems are going to start coming to a head in his second administration, and his response to these problems isn't always going to be the best response. And what we're going to see is that Jefferson's reaction will start pushing the U.S. towards war, in particular with Britain, and it's not just going to be him having to deal with these problems, but the person who's going to succeed him as president. So Jefferson, think about him as being good domestically, but he's going to have a mixed record when it concerns foreign affairs. Well, one of the things that's going to be facing Jefferson, and this is something that's going to be facing both his first and second administration, is he's going to have a number of difficulties dealing with these various Barbary nations of Northern Africa. So these Barbary states, as you'll sometimes see them referred, are basically these large swaths of land that are controlled by individual cities. Okay, so for example, you have this Tripoli area. It's basically controlled by this Pasha in the city of Tripoli. Tunisia is controlled by Tunis and the Pasha that rules there. And these Pashas are going to exert this influence over this large region. And one of the things these Pashas are going to do, and one of the things that these Pashas are going to do to make money, is they're going to sanction pirates within their cities. So we're going to start talking about this group known as Barbary Pirates. You can't really say this is officially the navy of the Pashas or the navy of these Barbary states. It's basically individuals that own these small pirate vessels. And what they'll do is they'll head out into the Mediterranean, find private merchant ships, attack them, capture their goods, and then return to these various Barbary states where the Pashas will allow them to trade the goods, including, you know, whatever fine goods they capture from the ship, including slaves, if they take sailors from these ships, and they'll allow them to trade in their Barbary ports. So the way this would work is you would have these pirates leaving from, and we'll just use Tripoli as an example, leaving from Tripoli, and they would go out, and let's say they're they come upon this vessel trading olive oil from Sicily to southern France. And so you have this merchant vessel owned by Sicily, some merchant in Sicily, heading in this direction. These Barbary pirates are going to come upon the ship. The Barbary pirate ships usually smaller, but they'll operate in large numbers, surround the merchant vessel, disable it, maybe fire a cannon that will disable the mast, the merchant vessel being unable to travel. Then the Barbary pirates are going to cross over, capture its sailors, capture its cargo, sometimes capture the ship itself, and then they'll take the goods and the sailors, and they'll bring them to these Pashas or bring them to these Barbary ports, where the Pashas will allow them to offload the goods for a percentage of whatever they make. So the pirates come in, they sell these Sicilian sailors to a rich merchant as slaves, they sell the olive oil to traders within here, and then the Barbary Pasha gets a percentage of what they take. You can think about these Barbary pirates in the same way that you would think about the pirates operating off the east coast of Africa a couple years back, where you would have them leave out of places like Somalia, I believe, is one of the places. They would go out, capture an oil tanker, bring the crew and the oil into port, and then sell the oil or sell whatever goods they took. It's not necessarily the Barbary Pashas that are conducting these things. He's not ordering the pirates, but he is sanctioning them by allowing them to trade in these ports. So these Barbary pirates have been operating out of these various areas really for hundreds of years. I mean, you can go all the way back to 1500s, 1600s, you would see these Barbary pirates going around the Mediterranean. But they've become especially a problem in the 1700s. As a matter of fact, the Spanish had such a problem with Barbary pirates. They tried invading and taking over some of these cities where the Pashas lived, all unsuccessfully. So what a lot of nations had started to do to deal with these Barbary pirates is not attack them, and it was too expensive to station naval vessels with every ship that traveled in the Mediterranean. So what a lot of nations started to do, in particular this is Britain and France, they would just pay off the pashas and tell them, tell the pirates that are operating in your port not to attack a ship if they see it's flying a British flag or a French flag. Those vessels are off limits. And the pashas would get a bribe, and then in exchange for this bribe, he'd tell the pirates, leave those ships alone. So you can continue to attack, you know, this Italian city-state ships, ships coming from Sicily, Greece, wherever, just not British and French ships. So they would bribe the Barbary pashas. The United States actually did this as well. George Washington and John Adams, they signed these various treaties with these Barbary pashas, giving them money to not attack American merchant vessels. So American merchant vessels would be coming over here to trade in the Mediterranean, and these Barbary pirates would see a ship flying an American flag. Hey, we're supposed to leave them alone. The pasha said so. Well, in signing these treaties, U.S. is giving a lot of money as bribes. So much money as bribes that by the end of John Adams' administration, some 20% of the United States budget was going to pay off pashas to not have their Barbary pirates attack American merchant vessels. That's a lot of money. And the U.S. is only able to afford this through things like the whiskey tax, stuff like that. Well, what's going to happen is that same thing that you would see happening if you had, say, gangsters, mobsters, or something ask for protection money from a store. We're going to keep people from attacking you if you pay us off. You give them 10 bucks one week, next week you give them 20 bucks, following week they're going to ask for 30 bucks, and eventually these bribes are going to go up and up. Same thing happens to the United States. Every year, when you form a new treaty, the price to stay away from American merchant vessels keeps going up, keeps going up, keeps going up. Well, when Jefferson gets into office, he's going to inherit this huge budget of paying off these Barbary pashas. Well, the U.S. has already signed treaties with a number of the pashas, and he's going to honor those treaties, continue to pay the money for those treaties, but some of the treaties are going to expire, and you're going to have these pashas, and in particular, one pasha from this Tripoli, the Barbary state of Tripoli, will ask Jefferson for additional bribes. I want more than we were receiving before. Give me additional money. Well, Jefferson's going to look around, and he's not going to be able to pay this. Basically, he had gotten rid of the whiskey tax, reduced the size of the budget of the United States, and the U.S. government's only getting its money in the form of duties and in land sales. So if he were to pay off this Barbary pasha, that would mean either implementing taxes, which he said he didn't want to do, increasing the size of the military, which would also require taxes, and he doesn't want to do that. So he can't bribe him because it's going to require money. He could, again, hypothetically attack these cities, try to take them over, force them to sign a treaty that would say don't attack American merchant vessels, but that would require funding a lot of the army. He doesn't want to do that because it's going to cost money. And hypothetically, what he could do is he could build up the United States Navy and maybe blockade Tripoli or something like that, but that's going to require more vessels than the United States has on hand. One of the things Jefferson did upon first entering office was cancel these additional naval ships that John Adams had ordered built. So during the Quasi-War, John Adams had built 6 frigates. These were actual naval vessels meant for destroying other ships. Jefferson, when he takes over as president, he's going to keep those naval ships. He's not going to fire the sailors. He's going to pay for their upkeep. But these additional vessels that were in the middle of being constructed by John Adams, Jefferson is going to cancel their construction. So Jefferson only has 6 U.S. naval vessels. It's not like he can effectively destroy the Tripoli pirates or protect every American merchant vessel that's going into the Mediterranean. So Jefferson's going to be sitting here, 1801, 1802, 1803. What do I do about these guys? They want bribes, but I don't want to raise taxes to pay them. I don't have the military might to take them down, at least not alone, and I don't have the naval vessels. to escort every American merchant ship operating in the Mediterranean. But I also want American merchants to have the freedom to operate in the Mediterranean. I don't just want to tell them, don't go out there because these pirates are out there. So what Jefferson's going to do in response to this threat from the Tripoli Barbary pirates is he's going to decide to take what you would maybe define as a half measure. He's going to send a handful of the few frigates the U.S. Navy has, and he's going to station them near Tripoli Harbor, and with the idea that when American merchant vessels are operating in the area, either the U.S. naval ships can escort them, or they can operate near the harbor to make sure pirate ships don't go out after the vessels. So basically watch this harbor of Tripoli to keep the pirates from moving against American merchant ships. Again, not enough to take over Tripoli, not enough to protect every merchant vessel, but just basically patrol this area and watch for pirates leaving. If the pirates leave in the direction of American merchant vessel, then the U.S. naval ships can watch them. Well, you've got these American merchant vessels and these American naval ships. There's a couple of these frigates operating in this region, one of which is the USS Philadelphia. And the USS Philadelphia is right outside of Tripoli when something is going to happen to the ship. So these Barbary pirate ships are incredibly small. There's a reason for this. One of the reasons for this is that when this area off North Africa, the ocean is incredibly shallow. It's sandbars are very low, or I'm sorry, very high out here. Ships with deep keels are gonna get stuck in the sandbar. Apparently, the captain of the USS Philadelphia didn't realize this because as he was sailing his ship outside of Tripoli, the Philadelphia is gonna get stuck in one of these sandbars. It's gonna get stuck, and you can sort of imagine this like a car. You're trying to get out of mud. You can't go anywhere. So this Philadelphia is going to be sitting here stuck in the sandbar. Its sailors can't do anything when a bunch of Barbary pirate ships are going to start surrounding the vessels. Again, if you try and fire on the ships, first of all, the cannons are basically aimed in the air. But, all the Barbary pirates basically have to do is get out of range of the cannons, and you can't do anything to turn to meet them, to fire back at them, because you're stuck in a sandbar. So this is going to allow these Barbary pirates to board the Philadelphia, take the sailors of the Philadelphia into custody. They're then going to bring them into Tripoli, where they're going to be sold as slaves, and a number of Barbary pirates are going to take up on the Philadelphia and begin the process of digging it out of the sandbar to possibly use as a pirate ship. So I want you to imagine that you're Thomas Jefferson, and one of the few naval vessels you have. Again, the U.S. Navy at this point is only six frigates. 1/6 of the Navy is now in the hands of pirates. So if we were comparing this to modern day times, this would be like a U.S. aircraft carrier being captured by pirates on the coast of Somalia, and they're about to be cruising the aircraft carrier around the world with this American flag flying over it. This is going to make you a laughing stock if this happens. Basically, Britain, France, look at these dumb Americans. They've got a ship got stuck, and now the Barbary pirates are using it as a pirate ship. They're laughing. Look, they can't get their stuff together. So what are you going to do about this, Jefferson? How are you going to handle things? One thing Jefferson is going to do in 1804 is he will raise duties on incoming goods from the Mediterranean only. We need more protection out there. I simply can't just run things on the duties as they currently exist in land sales. I need to increase duties somewhere. So he's going to take that money and he's going to begin construction of additional naval vessels. We'll talk about those in a second. All right, so that's going to be to deal with Tripoli. What about dealing with this Philadelphia? How are you going to prevent the pirates from taking this thing around as their new vessel in their pirate fleet? Well, for this, Jefferson is going to look to this guy right here, Stephen Decatur. He does not look like a tough dude whatsoever, but the guy's got an incredibly interesting backstory. His father had been a merchant sailor during the American Revolution. He turned his vessel essentially into a naval ship, had attacked the British during the American Revolution. When the Quasi-War broke out, Stephen Decatur had joined the Navy, become one of the first naval captains of this new United States Navy, and successfully fought the French in a number of engagements. Decatur, you know, a little bit of interesting backstory. He's certainly not a pacifist. You wouldn't qualify him like that, but there's a story where he once got in a duel with somebody that was talking smack about the U.S. Navy. This guy insulted the Navy, Decatur said, and then in the new United States, Decatur said, take that back. The guy said no. The guy basically challenges him to a duel. Decatur doesn't want to shoot this guy and kill this guy over a simple insult. So he basically shoots the guy in the hip to prevent him from being able to pull his weapon and fight back against him. And then, you know, again, still shot somebody, but he prevented that guy from basically dying by shooting him in the hip intentionally. I'm sure, actually, that guy, after he left, died of infection. But Decatur at least thinks that the guy's life was saved. So pretty tough dude, okay? He might not look tough, but he's a tough dude, a lot of experience. Well, Jefferson's going to go to him shortly after the Philadelphia gets stuck off the coast of Tripoli. So the Philadelphia gets stuck off the coast of Tripoli, 1803. And he's going to say to Decatur, do something about this. I don't want that ship to fall into Barbary pirate hands. So what Decatur was going to do is he will purchase a small merchant vessel that's used to trading in the Mediterranean. So something that you would see bringing olive oil or, you know, wool or whatever from one port in the Mediterranean to another. Decatur is then going to get a number of Marines. So think about these U.S. Army soldiers, naval officers with combat experience, and he's going to stick them below deck on this merchant ship. He's then going to hire an Arab translator. You would basically see these type of guys operating, you know, between American, or not American, between particularly British merchant vessels in the Mediterranean, because you need somebody to talk to the pirates. They come up to you, hey, I'm a British vessel, something like that. So he's going to hire this translator, and then he's going to fly above this merchant vessel a British flag. Not an American flag, but a British flag. So what Decatur's doing here is disguising this ship as a British merchant vessel. And he's doing this because Britain has a treaty with the Pasha of Tripoli to where the pirates aren't supposed to attack British ships. And as a matter of fact, you see British vessels trading in Tripoli fairly regularly. So Decatur's going to get his merchant ship full of U.S. Marines, and he's going to pull into the harbor of Tripoli and pull up to the USS Philadelphia stuck in the sandbar. Well, the Arab translator will call over to the pirates on the Philadelphia and basically say, hey, I'm a British merchant vessel. We're having a problem. We need to tie up to your ship to fix the problem. So the pirates on the ship will, thinking this is a British merchant vessel, will agree, tie the ship up. And the second that happens, all of these American sailors, Marines, are going to pop up from below deck of the merchant ship. They're going to then crawl over onto the Philadelphia, and they're going to start going from one room to another in the Philadelphia, killing these various pirates they encounter. And in what's basically like a 10-20 minute raid, they're going to plant all these incendiary devices throughout the Philadelphia. As soon as they've got everything planted, Decatur and his guys are then going to return back to the merchant ship. They're going to ignite the fuses, set the fuses off as they leave, and you're going to see the USS Philadelphia. So imagine, this is a picture from a little bit earlier. Let's imagine Philadelphia is stuck right around there. They're then going to light it on fire, and they and the merchant vessel they're on are going to start escaping Tripoli Harbor. So all these pirates on land see what just happened. It's very apparent that this American group has tricked them. And Stephen Decatur is going to take off. You're going to see all these Barbary merchant vessels then take off in pursuit of them. Stephen Decatur is going to be going out to the Mediterranean. He's actually about to get surrounded by a series of Barbary pirates, but at the last second, an American frigate that was in the area to support these operations will block the Barbary pirate, allowing Stephen Decatur to get away. Very Michael Bay movie-ish. You know, you have this explosion of the U.S. vessel. Again, you lose 1/6 of your Navy, but it's better than losing it to pirates, having this U.S. vessel as a pirate ship. So at least, Jefferson, you've got that part solved. What about your sailors that are now in slavery in Tripoli? And what about future relations with Tripoli? They're going to continue to attack American merchant ships. Well, what Jefferson is going to do is he will send out messages to other smaller nations that have been attacked by these Barbary pirates. So places like Sicily, he's going to send some word to these city-states down here. Again, Italy's not Italy just yet. It's still a bunch of small city-states. Same thing with Greece. And he's going to send word, hey, you guys, we're putting together an expedition to attack Tripoli. If you can send vessels to support this expedition, this would be great. So he's going to start putting together this multinational navy to blockade Tripoli Harbor. And with this multinational navy is going to arrive these new American merchant vessels, or new American naval vessels. So the U.S. has its big frigates, the ones built by John Adams, but added to them by July 1804 will be these new vessels that Thomas Jefferson commissioned to be added to the U.S. Navy using the duties from incoming Mediterranean goods. Now, the thing with these vessels, they're specifically designed for the coast of North Africa. They're these smaller vessels with very shallow keels that aren't going to get stuck in these sandbars. And again, this is specifically designed for the coast of North Africa, so they're not the bigger naval vessels. They're these smaller ones. So you got these smaller naval vessels along with a handful of the U.S. frigates. They're going to surround Tripoli Harbor, basically with the intention of getting into Tripoli, then perhaps invading, maybe taking the Pasha and then forcing him to sign a treaty, maybe rescuing the American sailors, but ending this the Barbary pirates attacking out of Tripoli. Unfortunately for the Americans, they're not going to be able to get into Tripoli Harbor because the harbor is going to be protected by all these Barbary pirate ships. And what you're going to see go on from July, throughout July 1804, is basically a series of small naval battles as the U.S. Navy tries to pierce the Barbary pirate vessels to get into Tripoli. So there'll be one ship engaged with, you know, one American vessel. Maybe this Barbary pirate ship comes out here. This vessel goes to engage it. Maybe the Barbary pirate ship wins. Maybe the American vessel wins. But you'll see a series of smaller engagements throughout the month. One of these engagements is going to involve Stephen Decatur's little brother, a guy named James Decatur. So James Decatur had been placed in charge of one of these new smaller vessels. And basically a Barbary pirate ship was separated from other Barbary pirate ships. James Decatur's ship goes to engage it. They're firing cannons back and forth. And it looks like that James Decatur has just disabled the Barbary pirate vessel because the captain of the vessel is going to signal that he surrenders. Basically, you know, you don't want you and your sailors to die. A lot of sailors back then didn't even know how to swim, so you just surrender the American vessel. The Americans are then going to cross over, take the vessel into custody, you know, do whatever with the sailors, either imprison them or maybe just let them off nearby, but you capture this vessel. You've just won the battle. So James Decatur is going to pull up next to the Barbary pirate ship with the intention of taking it over. He and a handful of his officers are going to cross over into the Barbary pirate vessel to take it over. The second that they do, out from below decks, these pirates are going to pour out onto the deck, way more than James Decatur would think would be on a vessel of that size. And they're going to surround James Decatur and the men who had crossed over in the pirate vessel. The Americans that are on James Decatur's ship see what happens. They realize they will get taken over if they allow the Barbary pirates to cross into their ship. So they're going to disengage from the Barbary pirate vessel and go back towards the rest of the American fleet. The last thing they see is basically James Decatur being stabbed by this Barbary pirate. So what then happens is an American vessel will go back to the American fleet and report what's just happened. And they're going to report it to Stephen Decatur, the same guy that blew up the Philadelphia. This is a couple months later. And they're going to say, hey, Stephen, your brother James has just been stabbed by these pirates. Probably doesn't have long. This is the vessel. So Stephen Decatur is going to take his ship and go to engage the Barbary pirate ship that his brother's on. Stephen Decatur engages this ship in battle, is eventually going to disable it, and Stephen Decatur and his men at that point are then going to cross over onto the Barbary pirate vessel, and what's going to happen is something very similar to what you would see on, you know, one of those pirate movies. You basically got somebody fighting with this sword over here. Think about, like, you know, any pirate movie you'd ever see. There's a cutlass is going here and here. This is the way at least Stephen Decatur describes it. But you got this guy right here doing this maneuver. Maybe somebody comes up behind him. They do the block behind the back with that sword. You know, maybe somebody comes around with a double-bladed thing a la Darth Maul. And you got these guys fighting from on the vessel, this pirate vessel. And Stephen Decatur, I kind of like to imagine him like, James, where are you? He's sitting here fighting all these pirates, you know, and the fellow sailors are fighting the pirates. Pirates are killing some sailors. Sailors are killing some pirates. Pirates killing sailors. And it's just this huge, you know, huge naval battle fought on this pirate ship. Well, eventually Stephen Decatur is going to fight his way toward the Barbary pirate captain, the guy that the fellow sailors reported as stabbing his brother. Stephen Decatur makes his way to this guy, and they're going to get into this sort of cutlass fight. They'll be, where's my brother? What'd you do to him? I'm going to kill him, or whatever, the Barbary pirate captain, and he's going to be fighting. Apparently, the Barbary pirate captain's a really big guy, and he's going to bring down his cutlass on Stephen Decatur, cutlass incredibly hard, and Stephen Decatur's cutlass will shatter and fall to the ground. It's going to break. Barbary pirate captain at that point is going to get on top of Stephen Decatur, and he's going to grab this dagger, and he's going to pull out the dagger and prepare to stab it in Stephen Decatur's chest. And you know, we've all seen this scene in the movies where you have the guy on top, he's about to get the dagger and drive it down the guy, and you know, he's got gravity going with him, and the guy under him is sort of, no, you know, about to die, and then the situation's playing out. Well, the knife starts to go into Stephen Decatur's chest, and Stephen Decatur, oh no, you know, life's about to go out of him. Then out of nowhere he realizes, oh, I have a loaded pistol, and he pulls the pistol out, shoots the pirate captain in the head, and then kills him. Well, at that point, the rest of the sailors are going to start clearing out the Barbary pirates, imprisoning them or killing them, and they're going to gain control of this Barbary pirate ship. Stephen Decatur is eventually going to locate James Decatur, and I'm not 100% sure if this is how things happen, but I like to imagine it this way. He finds his brother barely holding on to life, and he says to James, you know, James, you know, I found you. Stephen, you know, it's good to see you, buddy. And Stephen says to James, you know, hey, buddy, we're going to get you back to my vessel. We got the best doctors in the fleet. You're going to be okay. And James Decatur, you know, the life's draining out of his eyes, like, you always were a good liar, Stephen. I'm not long for this world. And Stephen's like, don't you give up on me, little brother. You're going to make it. And James Decatur, tell Mom I love him. Tell Mom I love her, Stephen. And Stephen's, James, no. And then James, you know, his eyes close, and Stephen Decatur sitting there holding the body of his brother, like, Barbary pirates, and he's all angry or whatever. Again, that's not exactly how it happened, but pretty close. So anyway, Stephen Decatur does manage to take out this vessel, and you do see some other engagements where the U.S. Navy does clear out some of the Barbary pirates, but they still can't get into the main harbor of Tripoli. There's still enough of these pirates that they cannot get in and penetrate this wall. As a matter of fact, the United States takes a merchant vessel they loaded with explosives, try to pull that thing that Tyrion Lannister pulled at the Battle of Blackwater Bay, and explode this ship in the middle of the Barbary pirates, like almost like a floating car bomb. But the Barbary pirates get out of the way in time. It's not effective. So by the end of July 1804, the U.S. is still not in Tripoli, and it doesn't look like they're going to be able to get in using their navy. So Jefferson, he's going to be looking around, you know, what the heck, how can we prevent these pirates from attacking? At this point, he's going to continue this, like, international search for others that have been attacked by the Barbary pirates. Again, not the bigger nations, they pay them off, but nations like these smaller Greek city-states. And Jefferson is going to get some sailors, and these sailors and some mercenaries and some volunteers from these other city-states are going to come up with a plan. Instead of attacking Tripoli from sea, what if we attack it from land? What if we take out all the smaller cities that Tripoli, you know, rules over? We take those out, and then we eventually move on Tripoli. So we don't head straight for the main city, but we move slowly on the bigger city. And Jefferson is actually going to get these diplomats to meet with the Pasha of Tripoli's brother, who had taken exile in what's today Egypt. So we all have seen Game of Thrones. We know that, you know, you'll have brothers and sisters disagree on who should take over ruling, you know, after dad dies or whatever. And, you know, they'll fight it out, and then one person will rule, and then whoever, you know, loses is either going to die or going to have to, you know, go into exile. Well, the Pasha's brother's over here in Egypt. He thinks he should be ruling instead of his brother. So Jefferson's forces are going to get into contact with this guy, and they're going to make an agreement that let's combine our forces. We'll get these Greeks together. We'll get these American Marines, American sailors together. And what we're going to do is march along the coast on the way to Tripoli. We'll have the U.S. Navy supporting us along the way. And basically, we'll take out the dependencies or the sort of sub-cities of Tripoli before taking Tripoli itself. So when you're going to see in 1805 is this force that's going to be made up of, again, U.S. sailors, Greek mercenaries, and some 600, actually 600 total, but hundreds of men under the Barbary Pasha's brother. So it's going to be this multinational coalition, multi-religion, Muslim soldiers, Christian soldiers, marching to take out Tripoli. And what's going to happen is these forces will start moving along, taking out these smaller cities until they reach what's the second biggest city in the Tripoli Barbary state, a place called Derna, or you'll hear it say Derna probably perhaps more often, this smaller city. And you're going to have the U.S. Navy start bombarding it from sea, the Marines and their allies, the Pasha's brothers' allies, their mercenary allies, will take out Derna, and then they're going to raise the flag of the United States above Derna, and then they're going to start marching on Tripoli. So we've taken out the second biggest city. Now we're on our way to take out the biggest city. Well, it's at this point that the Pasha of Tripoli realizes, man, these guys are going to end up taking me out. I've got to make a deal with them. So the Pasha of Tripoli will make an agreement with the United States to give back its sailors and agree not to attack American merchant ships if they give up attacking Tripoli. United States will agree to this. It's going to get its sailors returned. And yay, Jefferson, you've gotten this smaller nation to back down and respect U.S. neutral rights. And we'll see that these other nations are going to take notice, because when time comes up for the treaty to sign with them, they're going to be hesitant to ask for additional bribes. Now, there'll be a second Tripoli, or there'll be a second Barbary War, not nearly going to be as involved as the first, but for the most part, these guys will back down from demanding these bribes. So Jefferson's exerted U.S. influence and basically gotten these guys to respect U.S. neutral rights. So for the most part, you're thinking, yay, Jefferson, this is a victory for America. Unfortunately, I once had a TA who wrote a paper on this, and he explained to me that one of the conditions of this treaty and agreeing to stop attacking American merchant vessels was that American forces had to abandon the Pasha's brother and abandon their support for him. So they sort of slunk off, and this poor guy who had fought with the United States, the U.S. sort of backs off. He gets captured by his brother, and last I heard that he was thrown into the dungeons of Tripoli. So we sort of, you know, didn't really help out one of our allies here. But, you know, I guess you respected American neutral rights, so at least the U.S. has got that going. So for Jefferson, this is a foreign policy victory. So, you know, again, forget the minor consequences. Overall, for the United States, this is a victory. All right, so Jefferson, you've got that on your ledger, dealing with foreign powers. You've got the smaller nation to step down. What about the big dogs? Well, this is where Jefferson's going to stand up or see a lot of problems. So 1803, after about a little over 3 years of peace between Britain and France, Once again, these guys are going to go to war. So we see this again constantly. Austrian succession, then the Seven Years' War, American Revolution, French Revolution, Britain and France are fighting one another. And in 1803, they start fighting one another yet again. These guys cannot keep the peace. We see them going to war. And once again, this is going to be Napoleon leading France into this war. Well, the U.S., when the war starts, Jefferson, again during the French Revolution, had basically said, I support the French in the Revolution when they were trying to push their Republican government, but he didn't want the U.S. to get involved. Now we have a monarchy fighting what's essentially a monarchy in Napoleon in Europe, and Jefferson's going to be thinking the same thing. I don't want to get involved in this. And this is going to be somewhat problematic because what we're going to see is that this new war is going to basically engage just about the entirety of the globe, or at least the countries that the U.S. deals with. Russia will side with Britain. France and Spain are going to team up, and we're going to get a bunch of these smaller countries in the middle of Europe teaming up with one side or another. And once again, you know, there's going to be pressure from both sides for the U.S. to side with either the British or side with the French. Pick a side, United States. Jefferson does not want to pick a side, particularly because he doesn't like France anymore, because he doesn't like Napoleon, he doesn't like Britain, has never liked Britain. So he doesn't want to pick a side for those reasons. And he realizes that the U.S. is going to make money being a neutral party, because if two nations are at war, they want to get an advantage over the other guy, they're going to pay high dollar to a third party to get what they want. So Jefferson realizes if U.S. merchants can sell to the warring parties, both warring parties, they're going to make a ton of money. He doesn't want to take a side in this war. Now, unfortunately for Jefferson, when this war starts 1803, the U.S. is still bound by Jay's Treaty until 1805. So Jay's Treaty says the U.S. can't trade directly between French ports, and it's got to give lower duties to British goods. So you can't trade directly between French ports. Well, France has, even though they're lost Haiti at this point, they still got a number of sugar islands in the Caribbean, and so they got to get these goods to these areas. Let me find a better picture of this. Oh boy, I guess I don't have a better picture of this. Well, so Jefferson, they want to get these goods to these ports down here, but again, you can't trade directly between France and its colonies, or France's allies and its colonies. The Jay's Treaty says that. So what we're going to see is American merchants are going to sort of come with an end around to this. I don't know if that's the right term, but France wants to get goods here to its sugar islands, the ones it has left, and the sugar islands want to get sugar to France. Same thing, since Spain's its ally, they're coming under this treaty as well, and they can't get past these English merchants. Well, American merchant vessels are supposed to abide by Jay's Treaty, can't trade directly between these two, unless you stop in a U.S. port. So what's going to start happening under Jefferson from 1803 to 1805 is American merchants will stop at these French sugar islands. They'll then come up here, high-five duty collectors, essentially in the American colonies, then head over to France. Or maybe they'd be trading between two French sugar islands, come up here, high five, then go back down to the other one, island over here. And if the British, they're with their navy, are going to be blockading these islands, but the Americans are going to say, not violating Jay's Treaty because I stopped an American port first. So Americans are going to start making a ton of money off of this this war. And as we're going to see, the British are going to have to stand by until 1805, because technically this broken voyage, as we're going to call it, broken voyage meaning stopping in the United States before continuing on to France or a different French colony, Jefferson's going to give thumbs up to it. I don't like Jay's Treaty in the first place. I'm acknowledging that we're under it until 1805, but this isn't technically violating it. So British captains until 1805 are going to have to be put up with it. Well, 1805, Jay's Treaty officially ends. Jefferson's not going to renew it. So now we no longer have these duties under lower duties on British goods, and we can now trade directly between French ports without doing the stopover in these American ports. So Jefferson's kind of happy with this. Well, the second the Americans start doing this, Britain will start doing exactly what it was doing during the French Revolution when American merchants were trading these areas. It starts seizing American merchant vessels. So even if they're not carrying war material. So as we talked about, the way the United States understands these rules of neutrality is we understand that our ships can be seized if they're trading war materials with a warring party, but if they're trading non-war materials, any ship's supposed to let them go by. But as we talked about in the French Revolution, the British started seizing the non-war materials anyway. Well, they're going to start doing that yet again in 1805. So Washington had responded to that by signing Jay's Treaty, essentially siding with the British, bending the knee. Jefferson doesn't want to do that. So the British are now seizing American merchant vessels trading with French ports, violating U.S. neutral rights. And they're not even stopping there, because they're going to start doing something they'd done to a degree in the French Revolution, but they're going to kick this up a notch in the during this new war between France and Britain in the early 1800s. Whenever they stop American merchant vessels, they're going to start seizing their sailors and impressing them into the British Navy. So an American merchant ship, let's say it's going down to a French port, bringing corn, wheat, something like that. They start to pull up the French port. Right before they get there, a British naval vessel will stop them and say, either, you know, let me inspect your cargo. And, you know, maybe they inspect it, maybe they let them go, maybe they seize them even if they're carrying non-war materials. But a lot of times these British vessels will simply stop the American ship and they'll ask to inspect the crew. And you're a merchant vessel, you're a guy that's meant to trade grain, you know, you can't fight this British vessel, so you have to stop and allow this British captain to cross over. He's going to cross over, and what these captains will do a lot of times, they'll look for deserters from the British Navy. This is actually very common. As we're going to talk about, being in the British Navy, not very good. So you would see a lot of deserters leaving the British Navy and escaping to American merchant vessels. Also escaping to the American United States Navy, because it's a lot better than the British Navy. So this captain will go on there. He's going to look at these sailors. Maybe he recognizes one as a deserter from his ship. I'm taking this guy on board with them. So they'll start doing that in 1805, but they're going to start taking more and more sailors. Like, their criteria for impressing, and I say impressing, this means taking, essentially kidnapping American sailor, putting them into service in the British Navy, is going to expand as time goes on. So first it's just deserters, then it'll be British citizens. So imagine this captain going up, expecting Americans and saying, where are you from? I'm from Virginia. I was, you know, born in 1785. The captain will say, all right, fine. What about you? My name is Bob. I was born in Massachusetts, born in 1786. And then next person, hello, governor. My name is Tom. I'm from, you know, and they'll be like, nope, you're British. You're coming into the British Navy. And they'll take these British citizens and put them into the British Navy. And again, it starts with deserters, then it goes to British citizens, then it will start going to, say, people that grew up in the United States but were technically born in the United States when it was under British rule. So let's say, what's your name? I'm Bob. Where are you from? Virginia. What year were you born? 1782. Oh, that was still under British rule then. You're coming into my Navy. So they start taking these American sailors and forcing them into service in the British Navy, impressing them into service. So this is going to be begin to happen in 1805. The British start doing this to a number of merchant vessels. Why would they have to do this? Well, they have to do it because, one, warfare has started to change. Basically, Napoleon had started to use these ships that had these hulls that were really thick. They were hard to get cannon through it. So the British had responded by putting these bigger cannons on board their ship that required something like 9 men to operate. So you need to put more men on the vessels because you need more men to arm these cannons whenever you're fighting a French vessel, simply because you need the bigger cannons. And you also have to do it because being in the British Navy, especially during wartime, sucks, okay? If you're in the British Navy, you're going to be traveling all over the place. The British Empire extends from, Britain itself, all the way around to, they're now in Australia. They have a lot of business in Asia, Hong Kong. They're going to South Africa. So you can be on board a British vessel for months on end. If you're in the U.S. Navy, U.S. is just, you're going up and down the East Coast of the United States. Maybe you go deal with those Barbary pirates in the Mediterranean. But even that's just a couple weeks, couple months. But if you're in the British, you're going to be going 6 months a lot of times. You got to go to British India, expect to go months around the Cape of Africa. And then by the time you get to India, you're going to spend a little time there. Then it's going to be a while to come back. As a matter of fact, India Pale Ale, that comes from the British vessels. They need to bring beer along, but they need high alcohol beer so it doesn't spoil. So India Pale Ale is this type of beer that the British would bring along, the high alcohol content beer in India, because they're on such a long voyage. So if you're in the British Navy, you could be going all over the place. You could be going, again, to the North Atlantic. You could go to the South Atlantic. You're going a long distance. So automatically there, this distance just makes it less preferable than nations without colonies around the world. And the longer, further distance, there's going to be more incidents of scurvy. People still hadn't figured out that this lack of vitamin C caused scurvy. So this isn't going to be a problem for most navies. If you're in the U.S. Navy just going up and down the coast of the United States at this time, then you're not going to get scurvy very much, because you're stopping in port every couple weeks at most. And so you're going to be eating fresh vegetables, stuff like that. If you're in the British Navy, you might not be stopping at a port for months. So without this vitamin C, our body, whatever evolutionary tick it is, starts rotting. You'll see people's flesh start rotting, fingers start falling off because of scurvy. So incidents of scurvy are much more prevalent in the British Navy. And in part because conditions are so bad, you would see a lot more mutinies in the British Navy. And because of this, you're going to see punishment being incredibly harsh in the British Navy. So to prevent sailors from rising up, taking over the ship, which happened fairly often in the British Navy, you would have a lot of punishment like flogging. The British would take sailors and they would flog them with this cat of nine tails, basically rip open their back if there was any talk of mutiny or disobedience. One of the punishments they had was something called keel hauling, where basically you would take a sailor who upset the captain, you would tie them up to this rope, and then you would drag them along the bottom of the boat where barnacles would rip open their back, and then the seawater is going to get in the wounds. You can imagine the pain that would be. As a matter of fact, if you're being dragged along the boat, you might be luckier if you die or you drown as you're going around, or maybe get cut open and lose a lot of blood before you make it to the other end. Because if not, you get to the top, you're going to be so in shock. A lot of times the people that go through this that survive, they just die of pain and infection from the wounds they received with keel hauling. Add on to this molestation that occurred in the British Navy. And all of these things make being in the British Navy bad and worse than serving in any other navy. So it does make sense that if you're a British sailor, you don't want to get keel hauled, you don't want to get molested, you don't want to get scurvy. If you stop somewhere and you can desert, but all you know how to be is a sailor, why not go work for an American merchant vessel where you can probably make more money in the British Navy? You're not going to get keel hauled, you're not going to get scurvy because you're not going to be out to sea for as long. And so you go over to this vessel. So the British, when they're impressing sailors, they legit are finding deserters from the British Navy. But a lot of times they're going to be taking people that were never in the British Navy, and again, people that are only nominally British citizens. And again, a lot of Americans they claim will be British citizens but won't actually be British citizens. So Jefferson's going to have to start dealing with this. How do you respond to this, Mr. President? The British are taking these Americans and impressing them in the British Navy. Well, Jefferson, he's going to look around. You can't necessarily go to war over a handful of sailors, especially when there's some question about whether or not they had actually deserted. So Jefferson's going to start protesting to the British government, but it's not going to be as a major issue just yet. So 1805, 1806, the British are impressing U.S. sailors, essentially kidnapping them. Again, though, these are private U.S. citizens on private merchant vessels. Well, something's going to happen in 1807 that's going to kick up American anger at the British even higher. And this is going to be involve this area right here. So this is Chesapeake Bay, and it's going to involve this naval ship called the USS Chesapeake. So the USS Chesapeake, and this is makes it convenient, is outside of Chesapeake Bay doing what U.S. naval vessels do. Again, if you're in the U.S. Navy, you're probably patrolling the coast looking for smugglers, people that don't pay their duty. You're also maybe protecting from potential invasion. You know, you got Washington, D.C. up here, so you're watching for invaders, but you're mainly, you know, cruising up and down the coast just doing your thing. So the USS Chesapeake's outside of Chesapeake Bay, just meandering about right here, when a British vessel, the HMS Leopard, is going to come up to the Chesapeake, and the HMS Leopard is going to pull up to the Chesapeake. So I should point out, this is American waters. It's right off the United States coast. This British naval vessel is going to come up to the Chesapeake and say, hey, lay down, pull up to us. We want to inspect you. So the captain of the Leopard calls on the Chesapeake to allow the British to inspect the American naval vessel. Now, this is a U.S. government ship. These are American sailors, employees of the U.S. government. British have now told them to allow them to inspect this ship and allow the British on board in American waters. Well, the captain of the Chesapeake understandably is going to say, no, we're not letting you on board. This is an American vessel in American waters. Get out of here. Well, the captain of the Leopard is going to say, we think that you have some deserters from the British Navy on board. Now, again, this is actually reasonable, because sometimes you'd see deserters from the British Navy join the American Navy. It's, you know, not as challenging as the British Navy, less chance of death. So that's not unreasonable, but the captain of the Chesapeake is going to say, I don't care. They're my sailors. This is American waters. You're not looking at it. You're not inspecting them. Well, when they refuse to allow the British to inspect the ship, the HMS Leopard is then going to fire on the USS Chesapeake, disabling the mast, preventing it from sailing, and then the Leopard will pull up to the Chesapeake, cross over, and then the captain will conduct an inspection of American ships. And by the way, when the British blew up the mast of the Chesapeake, it killed four sailors. Then they're going to inspect the U.S. vessel, and they're going to take another four American sailors into custody on the British ship. Two of them actually were deserters from the British Navy. Two of them were American citizens, however, but British take these four sailors onto the Chesapeake, and they've killed an additional four sailors, and then they leave the Chesapeake just floating there in the American waters, and then they take off back to Britain. So now you've had the British kidnap American sailors, and you've had them attack an American naval vessel. What are you going to do about this, Jefferson? Jefferson is furious. He's basically, this is not violating our neutral rights. A lot of people are going to say they're not respecting our independence. They're impressing our sailors, attacking our naval vessels. We should do something about it. And there'll be some people calling on Jefferson to support Napoleon and the French in their war against Britain. Either siding with the French militarily. We don't necessarily like Napoleon, but we don't like what the British are doing. So either siding with the French militarily or just trading with the French exclusively, cutting the British off from trade. Well, Jefferson, a little bit hesitant to do this because, you know, he realizes the British are going to step up their naval attacks on American ships is one thing, but he's also hesitant to do it because he really doesn't like Napoleon, and Napoleon's also refusing to disrespect U.S. neutral rights. So this is a cartoon from the time. So at the same time the Chesapeake Leopard affair occurs, Napoleon is going to enact something called the Continental System. So Napoleon has come to realize, Napoleon during this war had basically allied with much of Europe. He'd taken over other parts of Europe and created this huge French empire that extends almost all over Europe. Well, Napoleon and France, huge army, but it doesn't have the navy of Britain. So the French have been largely cut off from a lot of their colonies, can't get goods from their colonies. And again, the French had not industrialized to the degree Britain had. So Napoleon's going to be looking around and say, basically, we've got all of Europe, but we can't get goods from abroad. We don't want to give money to Britain, and even though they have the best manufacturing and they have goods that, you know, a lot of people in Europe would prefer to buy their goods from Britain just because they're better manufactured than anywhere in Europe. So Napoleon is going to implement in 1807 something he's going to call his continental system. So what this continental system will be is he basically is going to say to any place under French control, so France, its allies, or places occupied by France, you can no longer trade with Britain. We want to hurt them financially. We want to take away their customers for their industry. So what we're going to do is prevent their goods from being sold within Europe. So Napoleon implements his continental system, and he's going to say anybody caught trading with the British will have not only their goods seized, British goods seized, but any other goods they're carrying seized, and also the ship they're using to carry these British goods will also be seized. So this is going to be a problem for the United States, because you would have American merchant vessels trade in Europe, they would make stops in Britain, they would go to these other areas and bring British goods to these various ports. Well, when Napoleon announces this, and I shouldn't even say announces it, he's going to enact the policy, but before announcing it, he's going to order any ship with British goods on it to be seized. So you have a couple American merchant vessels doing business in Europe after doing business with Britain, and they've got these British goods. They're going to be seized by Napoleon. Napoleon will basically take them over for France and refuse to compensate the owners of the vessels for the goods he seized. And then he's going to say to the United States, we're not only seizing these vessels, but if any American merchants trade with Britain in this area, their goods are going to be seized. And the whole purpose of this continental system, cut off dependency on Britain for manufactured goods, get all the goods that France and its allies need within the continent of Europe. So now Napoleon has seized your ships. So now Britain is impressing your sailors, seizing your ships, and now the French are seizing your ships as well. So you cannot side with one over the other. So what the heck is Jefferson supposed to do? How are you supposed to respond to this? There's going to be some calls to cut the British and French off from these goods, from American goods. And actually, Jefferson wants to do that because he thinks both the British and French are dependent on American raw goods. He thinks the French rely on things like American iron to create their cannonballs. He thinks British manufacturing relies on American raw goods to manufacture. And that's true. They do rely a lot on American goods. So he's thinking, if I cut off both of these guys from American goods, it's going to hurt them so much, they're both going to come to the United States and say, hey, we're so sorry. We promise to respect your neutral rights. We promise to give you back the ships we seized, the French we seized, and then the British will compensate you for the stuff we seized. We'll promise no longer to impress your sailors. We're really sorry about what happened to the Chesapeake. He thinks that if he stops selling these two powers goods, they're so dependent on American goods, they're going to come back and promise to no longer violate U.S. neutral rights. So Jefferson starts coming up with a plan to prevent American ships from trading with those two powers. But somebody points out to him, you can't just stop trading with Britain and France because they're going to manage to get a hold of these goods anyway. So let's say if you trade with Sweden. I don't know much about Sweden during this war, but it looks like it's not an ally with France. And so let's say the Americans, this is a neutral nation, American merchant vessels start trading goods to Sweden, or maybe I've been trading goods to Sweden. Sweden doesn't have the same embargo with France that America does. So all Swedish merchants will do is then take these American goods and bring them to France, okay? Or maybe you go to Portugal, you trade with Portugal, it's not England, but then Portuguese merchants are going to trade the goods to Britain instead of the United States directly trading with them. So some people are going to point out that this an embargo on France and Britain won't work because they're going to get the goods anyway through these third parties. So you, Jefferson, need to take a stronger action to if you truly think these guys are dependent on American goods, you need to take a stronger action to prevent these goods from getting to these countries. So at the end of 1807, Jefferson is going to push through Congress something called the Embargo Act of 1807. You'll sometimes see it called the Embargo Act of 1808 because that's when it's going to go into effect. But this Embargo Act of 1807, what this will do is it is going to say that the United States merchants can no longer trade with Britain. They can no longer trade with France. They can no longer trade with these countries' allies. They can no longer trade with these colonies. And U.S. merchants cannot trade with anyone This Embargo Act of 1807 will actually cut off all international trade outside the United States. So we can't trade with Sweden, we can't trade with Portugal. US had started trading with China at this time. This cuts off trade with China. China doesn't have anything to do with any of this. This is just a place where American merchants are making a ton of money, but you can't trade with China off, out of the fear that merchants there would then take the goods over to Britain or France. And the whole thing here is that we're hoping these countries so dependent on American goods are going to come back begging the United States to trade with them again and promise to respect U.S. neutral rights. So this is passed end of 1807, goes into effect 1808. Jefferson's going to be sitting there. All right, now these guys waiting for them to come begging. That's not going to happen. What's going to end up happening is basically, French will start looking to its allies to get goods they used to get from the United States. So we used to get iron from the United States, can't get it from there anymore. Why don't we start doing speculating in some of the mines over here, start extracting iron from over here? Sure, it might be expensive, but it's the only option we have. Britain, all right, we're not getting goods from the United States. Well, let's go to our colonies in India, or let's go to our colonies in the Caribbean or South America and get the goods from there. So this is going to have the effect of cutting off the U.S. economy from international trade, which is obviously a huge part of the economy. U.S. is only going to be able to trade within the states. So it hurts the U.S. economy, and it's not even going to really hurt the economy of the guys the U.S. is trying to hurt because they find new sources for the goods. The French will be fine with stuff from the rest of Europe. British are going to be fine with their stuff from their colonies. So all Jefferson is going to manage to do here is destroy the economy. He's actually going to get a ton of criticism during this time. There's a lot of people that go up to him and protest, "Hey, we need our ship. Our ships, our sailors are out of work." You know, imagine just sailors sitting all sad at the end of docks, cobwebs growing along the sides of ships. We need to trade. There's actually a fun story about one leader that gets around the embargo. He finds a Chinese sailor. He pretends that he's a Chinese mandarin, which is a high Chinese official, and he basically says that this Chinese mandarin's grandfather died. He's a high official in China, and he needs to get out of the embargo to bring this mandarin back to China. Jefferson, "Oh, I'm sorry about that," and then allows the ship to go out of the embargo. Well, the ship gets over to China, trades a bunch of American goods for Chinese porcelain, and comes back. It was just a trick to get out of the embargo. But vast majority of people not going to be able to get around the embargo. You'll have some smugglers that will get around the embargo, but for the most part, it's just going to be a disaster for the economy. It's also a disaster for the United States government because if you think about things, that's how they're getting their money. They're not taxing anymore. They get most of their money from land sales in the West, so that's still going to be coming in, but also from goods coming into the United States. Now they're not coming in anymore. So U.S. government is going to have to cut back as well. So Jefferson received so much criticism about this. When 1808 comes up, he's just furious. Jefferson is like, "I'm tired of this criticism. I don't want to be president anymore." Again, there's no stipulation in the Constitution that presidents can serve multiple terms. So hypothetically, Jefferson could have run for a third term, but he's so criticized for the Embargo Act that he's going to decide not to run again, and he's going to decide to retire after a second term. And this is kind of how we get that two-term president precedent. Is Washington retired after two terms? Jefferson's going to do as well. And Jefferson's basically going to say to his bestie, his Secretary of State, James Madison, again, you know, this is a guy that's more qualified than anybody, father of the Constitution. "You run instead of me. I'm tired of this thing." And as we'll see, Madison will win the presidency in 1808. But the Federalist Party that had been on decline for a while, they actually do a decent showing here, and Madison is actually going to lose a handful of states to the Federalists, which a lot of people have predicted the Federalists have been dead by now. But Madison will win the presidency. Jefferson, after this, he gets so. Oh, and one thing, Madison, one of the first things he does is he gets rid of the Embargo Act. He says this was a failure. He still does limit trade with Britain and France, but you know, no more. We can trade with everybody else. We've got to get the economy up and running again. But it's such a disaster that Jefferson, I mean, it basically takes away, in Jefferson's mind at least, all that he accomplished with his first administration. Louisiana Purchase, that's not going to be his legacy, at least to Jefferson. He basically looks at it as everybody's going to view me as a failure because of the Embargo Act. And as a matter of fact, he goes into retirement from, in politics after this point. And we'll talk about him a little bit more. But from this point forward, he doesn't like to talk about the presidency, and he doesn't think of it as an accomplishment in his life. And you can actually see this on his grave. So the grave of Jefferson mentions nothing about him being president. It says author of Declaration of Independence, the Statute of Virginia for Religious Freedom. We talked about that very briefly, ensuring religious freedom in Virginia, and father of University of Virginia. Jefferson founds the University of Virginia. Does not mention anything about the presidency. He got so criticized for that. So now the person that has to take over is Madison, and he ends the Embargo Act, but he's still got the same problem. Both Britain and France are not recognizing U.S. neutral rights. The British continue to seize American ships, continue to impress U.S. sailors, and Napoleon is going to continue to step on American toes when to any Americans that trade in Europe. So how are you going to deal with this? Well, Madison's going to have a number of problems his first years as president, but things are going to come to a particular head beginning around 1810. What's going to happen in 1810 is there's going to start to be a series of problems in this Northwest Territory over here. So we talked about this area for a while. This is this area where all these smaller Indian groups, a lot of tribes that have been pushed west by the British and the Americans, had been pushed into this area. They'd lived in this region. They'd had a lot of contact with Europeans, initially the French, but since that point, Americans and British. A lot of these Indian groups had become Europeanized, adopt American customs. But they aren't like the densely populated groups like we see down here. Just a bunch of smaller tribes like the Shawnee, Ohio, Miami, groups like that. Well, these various Indian groups had continued to be pushed west by Americans. So we talked about how that Northwest Ordinance was supposed to work. Basically, the United States will send an official out to these areas. They'll make agreements with the tribes in these regions. Tribes will give up claim to a certain amount of land. And then after they give up claim to this land, they'll move west. The U.S. will then sell this land to American citizens. And once you get, 5,000 people, you become a territory, 60,000, you become a state. And by 1803, you'd had enough people in this Ohio area for it to write up a state constitution, enter as, would that be the 16th state of the United States. Well, these Americans continue to push west, and as they push west, you're going to see a series of these treaties being approved by American officials in accordance with the Northwest Ordinance. But the way the Northwest Ordinance was supposed to work is these U.S. officials would go to an area, offer goods for Indians as trade to Indians or promises of other land in other areas. And Indians were supposed to trade this land in this, meet with Indian leaders, meet with any Indians that occupied a certain region. So let's just say this region right here. Any Indian group you meet there, U.S. Citizens are starting to move in this region. So you meet with the tribal leaders, you offer them goods, promises, exchanges of things, and then you meet with all the leaders, you give them what they are asking for, and they agree to move west, give this land over to the United States. That's the way things are supposed to work. And you will see some treaties that are going to work that way. Some treaties, Indians don't need the land anymore. The population's been reduced significantly by disease. And, these goods, maybe needing farming implements, seeds or something, and you don't need the land. So you trade and it's a fair trade. That sometimes happened with this Northwest Territory. What would happen probably more often were things that were treaties that were deceptive, okay? So what would happen a lot of time is Americans would start moving into a region, and you would see that region starts filling up. Well, looks over here, we've got starting to use up all this land over there. We've got a lot of fertile, cheap land there, but there's a lot of Indians on this land that don't want to give this area up. So American officials and all these American settlers see this cheap land. How do we get it if the Indians in this area don't want to give it up? So what you would see is a lot of deceptive practices where you would not meet with every Indian leader, but instead those that were willing to play ball. So let's say there's five different Indian groups in this region, and you have three of them don't want to trade their land. Two of them, though, do want to trade the land. So you have an American official who was could be deceptive, and then he would only meet with the two leaders that wanted to play ball, gets them to sign over this land, and then they say to the other three Indian groups, all right, you've got to get off this land. Well, I didn't agree to leave. Well, these guys said that you did, and now this is American land. You got to go west. So these other groups are left with, we either go west or we attack the Americans. Well, this is what they want. You can then move in with your military, which is probably going to be superior to the Indian military most of the time. Then you move the Indians not only out of this region, maybe you force them to sign a treaty signing additional territory over. Or another thing you would see is you don't meet with the tribal leaders, so you have this guy's the established tribal leader, but his brother under him, incompetent, you meet with him, and you know, you get him to sign the treaty, and then when the chief of the tribe says, well, I didn't sign that, I'm the leader, nope, this guy signed it, you got to get out. And then your choice is either fight or move west. Other times you would see, you meet with the tribal leader, you get that guy intoxicated, then you, when he's intoxicated, you get him to sign over more land than he expected. Or, you know, for a lot of these guys who can't speak English, you write it, you tell him your the trade is for a small chunk of land, but in reality, the treaty says for a bigger chunk of land. And then Americans start moving in. Indians have a choice to either fight or move west. And again, if you fight, the Americans are going to come in and take the land from you anyway. So there was a ton of these deceptive treaties going on, and there's a lot. There's some American officials that made sure the treaties were honest, but there are a lot of American officials that were dishonest, okay? And there's going to be one particular treaty and one particular guy that's going to sign these treaties left and right, willy-nilly, that a lot of these treaties are going to be deceptive. And this guy's going to be named William Henry Harrison. So he was an army officer. He had overseen a number of treaties in the Northwest Territory that were of the more deceptive kind, you know, asking for getting more land than had been promised, you know, meeting with you know, certain Indian leaders that would play ball, not meeting with those that wouldn't. And he'd overseen a lot of these deceptive treaties. One treaty in particular, a treaty signed in 1809, is going to give the United States some 3 million acres of land called the Treaty of Fort Wayne. So approximately this land right here, what William Henry Harrison does, he's the official to sign the treaty, is he's going to call up not all Indian groups in this area, just those that are willing to sign over land. He leaves out certain Indians groups that he knows don't want to sign over their land, leaves them out of negotiations, and he's going to call the other Indians in these areas together. He's going to get them to sign the treaty. Then he's going to say to the other Indians living in this land, you've got to move out. This land's been signed over. Again, the Indians are going to be protesting. Well, we weren't present at the meeting. We didn't agree to sign over this land, and they're going to be upset. One particular person that will be upset is this Indian leader named Tecumseh. So Tecumseh is Shawnee. He's a Shawnee Indian, but it doesn't even really matter what Tecumseh is, because Tecumseh is basically, he's come to the conclusion that tribal affiliation doesn't matter, especially in this Northwest Territory. It's not important. What's important is basically sticking together as Indians. Tecumseh is going to look around. He'd actually fought in the Northwest Indian War in the 1790s. He was at the Battle of Fallen Timbers. And what he'd seen is the reason that the United States is able to get away with these deceptive treaties is because Indians are can be divided. He's going to say, we need to start dropping our tribal affiliations, and we need to unite together to resist American expansion. One way we need to do this is we need to all collectively agree never to sell over land. Because if one group sells over land, then the United States will interpret that as, okay, well, they sold over this land, then they're going to force the rest of us out. But if none of us will sell land, they can't pull that. So he's going to call on all of the Indians in this Northwest Territory to set aside their tribal differences, unite under this common Indian banner, and never sell land to the United States. So he will actually call on things like, you know, dropping, not European weapons, you need the European weapons, but returning to your native roots, going back to some native religions, stop dressing like Europeans, and partially start respecting sort of Indian customs. and going back to her turn in native ways. And he had started gathering a number of followers that agreed with him in this place he's going to call Prophet's Town. His brother's the prophet. He's sort of the religious element of this duo. So he's going to be calling on a return to Indian customs. The thing that's going to make Tecumseh a particularly effective leader is because he's really seen the Europeans do this over and over again, and he's studied their politics. He's also studied their military. He's, again, fought the Battle of Fallen Timbers, and he's become an expert on American military tactics. So after the signing of Treaty of Fort Wayne, Tecumseh is going to get a number of his followers, and he's going to decide to go confront William Henry Harrison and call him out for what's been happening in the Northwest Territory, and particularly to call him out for these poor treaties. So in 1810, Tecumseh and about 400 of his followers, again, these are not just Shawnees, these are a bunch of different Indian groups that come together under Tecumseh's leadership, will approach William Henry Harrison, his temporary home. It's a place here in what's today southern Indiana called Vincennes, Indiana. And he's going to approach William Henry Harrison. William Henry Harrison initially thinks there's about to be an Indian attack, but Tecumseh is going to say, no, I just want to talk to you. And he and William Henry Harrison are going to sit down in August 1810 to talk about the Treaty of Fort Wayne and treaties in this Northwest Territory in general. Now, the story goes that, this is probably a little bit of fictitious, but the story goes that William Henry Harrison sitting on one side of a bench, Tecumseh sitting on another side of a bench, and they start this heated conversation. And Tecumseh starts saying to William Henry Harrison, you got to stop with these BS treaties. You've got to, you know, meet with everybody. You've got to quit taking our land. You got to quit pushing us off our land. This is unfair. And as this conversation goes on, Tecumseh slowly moves down this bench to the point where he's starting to push William Henry Harrison off the bench. So as the conversation moves down, Tecumseh starts getting into William Henry Harrison's personal space to the point where William Henry Harrison has one butt cheek hanging off the bench. It's at this point William Henry Harrison's going to say, you got to stop pushing me. I need room. Well, Tecumseh's going to look at him and say, well, shit, you know, that's exactly what we're talking about. I don't know if that actually happened, but supposedly that happened. Well, after they get in this heated argument, Tecumseh's basically going to threaten William Henry Harrison and say, listen, you've got to stop with these treaties. You've got to return this land you took in the BS treaties. If you don't, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to ally with the British. I know you guys are having problems with the British seizing your ships and impressing your sailors, and you're thinking that war might come with them. If that happens and you continue with these treaties, we're going to ally with the British and we're going to push them out of this area and we're going to return Indian rule to the Northwest Territory. So he threatens William Henry Harrison, and at this point Tecumseh is going to take his warriors back to Prophet's Town, but Tecumseh is not going to stay there for long. What he's then going to do is he's going to start forming this Indian Confederacy. So he's already started getting recruits from this Northwest Territory to join him, but he knows this isn't going to be enough. He thinks that if Indians are going to effectively resist white expansion, they basically need to create a nation from here all the way to the Gulf Coast. And so you've got to get all Indians to unite together to more effectively resist the Americans. So Tecumseh, after touring in the Northwest Territory, he's actually going to travel all the way down here in the South. He's going to meet with Cherokee leaders, a lot of these Mississippi culture groups, Cherokees here in North Carolina and Georgia, meet with Creeks in Alabama and Georgia, meet with Choctaws and Chickasaws, these larger population groups, and try to encourage them to join his Confederacy. Now, most of these Indian groups, the Cherokees, Choctaws, and Chickasaws, they listen to Tecumseh, but they're going to say, thank you, but no thank you. We, by this point, we speak English. A lot of us speak French. We know how to deal with them. We're intermarrying with the whites. We think that our approach in not getting violent is going to be successful and is going to keep them off their land. We think that by joining you, you know, this will upset them. This might get them to move in and seize our land. We think our political approach is going to work. So thank you, but no thank you. Now, the Creeks down here, the largest Indian group, some of them are going to say, no, we don't, we think we're good at dealing with these guys, and we'll be able to keep them away. But some of these Creeks had started being pushed west by these settlers in Georgia, and they see what's happening up here as like a precursor to what's about to happen to them down there. And a lot of these Creeks are going to be calling for a return to their old ways. And when Tecumseh comes to visit them, it happens to be Halley's Comet appears in the sky at the same time. Some people say it's for that reason the Creeks are going to accept them. But the Creeks will basically tell Tecumseh, all right, if war comes with the United States, we will join you and we'll fight them. Okay? So 1811, Tecumseh's going around recruiting these Indian groups. He's unsuccessful for the most part in the South, except with the Creeks. But then he's going to be heading back to Northwest Territory shortly thereafter. Well, while Tecumseh is gone, William Henry Harrison learns what he's doing. And to William Henry Harrison, basically he sees Tecumseh as planning a rebellion. And he thinks that in order to stop this, he's got to be proactive. He can't just wait for Tecumseh to form his army. And William Henry Harrison, he actually respects Tecumseh, recognizes he's a qualified military leader. So what William Henry Harrison is going to decide to do while Tecumseh's gone, in November 1811, he's going to decide to attack Prophetstown, which is just north, right around this area, while Tecumseh's gone and his leadership won't be available to help his Indians fight. So Tecumseh's gone. William Henry Harrison's going to get up 1,000 militiamen, a handful of U.S. soldiers, in order to attack Prophetstown while Tecumseh's away. Well, they march up here, and then on the morning of November 7th, just a little bit away from Prophetstown, I'm sorry, the night of November 6th, just away from Prophetstown, the American forces are going to make camp close to this Tippecanoe River. So William Henry Harrison and his forces right here. The Prophet, Tecumseh's brother, who sort of this religious leader of this Indian movement, not as qualified as Tecumseh in political and military matters, learns that the Americans are just outside of town. It's to be something, Prophetstown, something looks like this. He's going to gather the hundreds of warriors he has under his command, and he's going to decide to attack them at night or very early in the morning while the Americans are unprepared. So, the Prophet will get his Indian warriors together, and they're going to attack at this Battle of Tippecanoe. Now, in a previous battle, the Battle of Wabash, Indian forces in Northwest Territory had caught these U.S. forces off guard, killed something like 60% of the force. Now, they're thinking the same thing's going to happen here. Unfortunately for them, William Henry Harrison had learned from that battle. He had his soldiers sleep by their weapons, basically sleep prepared for battle. And when the Indians attack, William Henry Harrison's forces are going to easily grab their arms and start defeating the Prophet's forces. The Prophet's going to manage to escape. Some of his warriors are going to escape. But in their escape, they're going to abandon Prophetstown and leave it to William Henry Harrison's forces. So William Henry Harrison defeats the Prophet's forces, and then he's going to march his army into Prophetstown. Now, when William Henry Harrison arrives in Prophetstown, what he's going to discover is crates of British weapons. And what he learns is that the British had recently learned about Tecumseh, learned that he was resisting American expansion, and had started providing Tecumseh and his warriors, the Prophet and the rest of the warriors, with weapons. What the British are doing, and what they have been doing for the past couple years, is basically arming Tecumseh to provide this buffer, because they saw how the U.S. was growing upset about their impressments and their ship seizures, and they want to, if war comes, they're going to basically have these Indian warriors serving as a buffer to American expansion. So we can keep the Americas from moving west by keeping these Indians strong. So William Henry Harrison will then report at the very end of 1811, we have proof, we defeated, not Tecumseh, he's gone, but we defeated his forces, and we've discovered that they're being supplied by the British. What you would basically have is British soldiers bringing these weapons down to Tecumseh's forces, and William Henry Harrison has proof of it. So now you're James Madison. You have British seizing your ships, impressing your sailors, In 1807, you had that Chesapeake Leopard affair. Now you have the British arming Indians in the Northwest Territory. This is almost the exact same situation George Washington faced in 1794. Almost exactly the same situation. We saw how Washington responded to that. He actually went to Britain, bent the knee, and signed Jay's Treaty, or the Senate approved Jay's Treaty after Washington and John Jay and Hamilton had sort of negotiated it. Then the United States, again, after Britain shoved its head in the toilet, sided with Britain economically against France. Madison doesn't want to do that. Again, as a Republican, they don't like the British. This looks like, once again, they're violating your independence. How are you going to respond to it? What are you going to do here? Again, the last time we bent the knee to Britain. Well, Madison, he doesn't want to bend the knee to Britain. He's also not sure that this is enough to go to war over. Yes, you're arming Indians. Yes, you're seizing ships. But is this war worthy? I don't know. So Madison's going to be spending the end of 1811, the very beginning of 1812, trying to figure out how to deal with the British. Well, at the time, a new group had entered Congress. As a matter of fact, in 1810, a lot of the old members of Congress had recently been voted out. And you saw these new, younger group of congressmen come in. Guys like this guy from Kentucky, Henry Clay, a guy from South Carolina named John C. Calhoun. These guys were not the old generation like Madison and Washington. They had not fought in the American Revolution. What they had done is they'd grown up hearing Dad talk about the American Revolution, fighting the British, all these victories. And these young guys, they've heard these stories, but they don't know the cost of the American Revolution. They don't know the economic cost that happened afterwards, the lives lost in battle. They just sort of heard the glorious stuff, which, you know, you can see Dad isn't going to bring up the fact that, you know, food was scarce in the years after. He's not going to talk about the bad stuff. He'll talk about, hey, we beat Britain. So you have a lot of these glory-seeking younger guys who look at the situation and they say, we've got to fight Britain. We can't have them shoving our head in the toilet. They're arming these Indians. They're seizing these ships. We've got to fight back. And they're going to start calling Madison to go to war. You'll actually sometimes hear these guys referred to as war hawks. If you hear the term war hawk, it's born right here in 1812 with these guys pressing Madison to go to war. We need to go to war. We need to fight the British. Well, Madison is going to be tormented because he does know the cost of war. He'd lived through the American Revolution. He'd saw the economic crisis that happened afterward. He'd saw, you know, people die in the war. He understands that it's not the glorious stuff these young guys are talking about. But again, he can't put up with Britain violating U.S. neutral rights. So I don't want to go to war, but I also don't want to let the British keep doing this. So he's hesitant to go to war. Well, something's going to happen in 1812 that will convince Madison that maybe the war hawks are right. He's going to start changing his mind about going to war. Now, we don't know exactly what happens, but we think that some of this might be that a lot of guys like Thomas Jefferson are convinced that Madison can use a war with Britain to promote this empire of liberty. Guys like Jefferson look at the situation and say, what's Britain doing right now? Well, they're busy fighting Napoleon. Napoleon is this huge monster over there, constantly fighting the British. You know, their naval battles, even though the British have a powerful navy, there's still the threat of invasion from France. Britain's allies in Europe are getting rolled over by France. France is pushing all the way into Russia. It looks like that, you know, the British are actively engaged. Well, Jefferson, writing from his home in Virginia, writing to Madison, is going to say, you know what made me a good president? Louisiana Purchase. That I bought this territory, added it to the United States. This is going to be the thing that I'm known for. Well, you, Madison, would be a great president if you doubled the size of the United States as well. And one way you can do that is by taking Canada. There's no better time to do this. And the way Jefferson and others who are going to be advising Madison are going to look at it is, right now the British are engaged, and the people of Canada Most of them are still of French ancestry, a lot of them Catholic, a lot of them don't like being under British rule. They're basically begging to become part of the United States. A lot of old American politicians basically thought everybody wanted to become part of the United States. And so these guys are going to argue to Madison, we can use this as an opportunity to expand the U.S. So we cannot do this unless we're at war with Britain. Normally, Britain would beat us in a war, but because they're engaged with Napoleon, I think we can win. And I think this war would be fairly easy and fairly easy to take Canada, but we've got to go to war first. So Madison hears these arguments that the British are weak now and the U.S. can expand, and then added to the violations of U.S. neutral rights, what you're going to see in 1812 is Madison finally say, all right, you know, let's go to war with Britain. And you're going to get both houses of Congress approving of this declaration of war. It's actually not by a significant majority. There are a lot of Americans that are going to look at this and say, wait a minute, we're going to war with Britain. They just seized a couple sailors, armed a couple Indians. This isn't enough for a war. And Madison himself is sort of hesitant to go to war. The British, they don't want this war. As a matter of fact, U.S. Is going to declare war on Britain. Word will arrive back in British Parliament. They're going to read, oh, Americans want to go to war. Well, shit, you know, we're just messing with them. We didn't think this was going to be going to war. And basically the way the Britain's going to look at this is, crap, we got to deal with Napoleon. You know, I don't know what these Americans are going on about, but we'll handle them later. But the British don't want this, but they will declare war back. So what we're going to talk about next is this War of 1812.